costs regarding our facilities. We have all those costs put together, and we're in the process of organizing those. I'll have these to you next board meeting. It's in a quad sheet format to give you an idea of map locations and details on the facility and total operating costs. So I apologize for not having those today, but I'll have those to you next board meeting. Chairman and Supervisors, the issue that we're facing here is the loss of an entire industry here in Navajo County and a substantial loss to the entire region and centered around coal power production. And we've talked about these numbers before. We're looking at a total of $1.2 million loss in our property tax collections. $1 million of that is from the Cholla Power Plant. We saw Generator 2 close down, which decreased our property values by $30 million. And reduced our property tax collections by over $200,000. So as the other generators come offline, we'll see a total impact of $1 million. There's also the property that's associated with the Cayenta mine. As that closed down in conjunction with the planned closure of the Navajo Generating Station, we also lose $200,000 in property tax collections. On sales tax, unfortunately, sales tax information is confidential. We cannot disclose that information publicly until we receive the express permission from business owners to do that. We are working on that, I hope to be able to provide that information, the specific sales tax numbers to you in a future meeting. But as of right now, we cannot legally share that information publicly. I can say that the total loss in sales tax will be greater than the loss that we are planning to see on property tax. And as I explained last board meeting, the loss in property tax here in Navajo County then impacts our state shared calculation, so we get hit twice on sales tax. And a reminder, we're already trending down this year in sales tax. We're expecting to come in $130,000 below budget on sales tax. So just in recap, we're looking at $1.2 million in property tax. Sales tax would be greater than that. The elected official's retirement plan with the state is going up $558,000 for us. That's a 129% increase from the current year, and we begin paying that next year. And beyond these big issues, we also just have the cost of doing business. And this is for any business owner to tell you the cost of technology. Our Microsoft contract will be going up over $40,000 starting next year. Like all other business owners, we're adjusting to the new minimum wage requirements in Arizona. We don't have a large number of employees that are impacted, but as you raise those bottom employees, the lowest paid employees, that compresses the wage scale to their supervisors and to their managers. And so we'll see some impact. It's not a great impact this next year, but it will continue to develop as the wage goes up in the next couple of years. And of course, health insurance. Any business owners in your businesses, in your line of work, healthcare costs are going up nationally. We're feeling the same. So the issue that we're facing is not unique to Navajo County by any means. This was just released this week. The San Juan Generating Station in the Four Corners area, which had already announced it was closing two generators this year, has announced that it may be entirely shut down in less than 5 years. That's 30 years ahead of schedule. We've shared the impacts through press releases. The county manager shared his note, details with employees. We've reached out with videos and on social media. And we've received a lot of feedback. And the feedback I've received falls into two groups. The first group is, what are we going to do? What's going to change? How will services change? How is this going to impact the community? And frankly, the second set of reactions that I've gotten is, you're crazy. This really isn't going to happen. And I admit to be a little confused by the second reaction, but I understand the emotion behind it. It's a huge loss for the region, and it is hard to swallow as we talk about such big numbers and big impact community. But along with that, I've heard a similar follow-up, which is, for Brian, you tell us every year that the sky is falling and everything seems to work out and nothing really changes. But I'd like to push back on that perception, if I could. We have seen substantial changes in our county, and our employees have felt this over the past decade. One of the most obvious ways we can see that is our capital. We've decreased our capital spending by 75%. Our vehicle fleet is now, average age is between 11 and 13 years old. Our heavy equipment average is 19 years old. But, you know, some belt tightening is good, right? Because we're conscientious. Our fleet staff do a great job of maintaining our vehicles and keeping them on the road. But you have to ask the question, when we're having to repair vehicles by replacing transmission and replacing engines on vehicles that already have well over 200,000 miles, is that the most prudent decision to do as you're managing a fleet and as you're trying to manage costs overall? On our heavy equipment side, we have not had the funds to buy new equipment, and our public works staff have been fantastic in going out and finding good deals on used equipment. And they're finding that in a lot of cases, this used equipment actually is more dependable and more reliable than the brand new equipment. So belt tightening has been good. It makes us make good decisions, but at the same time, we just haven't had enough money to do enough replacement. And so that's reflected in the average age of our fleet. Now, you and I can't necessarily see a server or a power array aging like we can a vehicle in the parking lot, but they do. They run out of warranty, they fall out of service, and they have to be replaced. And again, we ask IT staff to stay right on top of that. They do a fantastic job, and I can only imagine how stressful that is, trying to maintain equipment that we all depend on so much every day in top shape when it is aging and sometimes out of warranty. We've seen a lot of cost increases and changes in our staffing. We've reduced 93 positions over the past several years. That's a 12% reduction in our staffing level. Public safety retirement has increased over 254%. We've seen a 40% increase in healthcare costs. And at the same time, we have not been in a position to provide even modest increases in wages to our staff. The last was in 2014, which is about 2%. So as you see, as we share the cost of healthcare with our employees more and more, their deductibles go up, premiums go up, and our wages stay the same, they effectively take home less today than they did years ago. We have had some growth in sales tax and property tax since 2008, but I think you can see how quickly that dissipates as the state then increases its cost sharing with us in those cost shifts. So we've seen $8.8 million in cost shifts. About half of that is the general fund, about half is HERF funding. And just to put that in perspective, the general fund portion, that's nearly the cost of operating our jail for an entire year. So these are not small dollars that we're talking about. We're grateful that we have the opportunity to house federal inmates at our facility. We're grateful for the partnership with the sheriff. It's a very appreciated revenue source, but the populations that we receive ebb and flow over time. They can change over time. It's not a secure source of funding. We appreciate having it, but it's not something that we can absolutely depend on. We've also had the mandate from the state Supreme Court regarding cost increases for equipment and personnel. And court staff are looking at different ways to adjust to that, whether it's fees or creative use of staff and partnership, and we appreciate that. But again, these are all new costs that are coming up at the time. We're not seeing the increases in revenue that a lot of the other parts of the state are seeing. So with that background, we have some difficult decisions to make. We have two proposals to discuss today. We are mandated by the state to provide service in a lot of different areas. So we focused our efforts in developing reduction proposals in those few areas where the board has some latitude to make decisions and changes, and those which are not specifically mandated by the state. In the proposals that I'll show you, staff would be impacted. And we have begun coordination with the Northeastern Arizona Innovative Workforce Solutions Group to provide job training for counseling and job search assistance to impacted employees. And bringing this before you now for your consideration gives us time to plan to communicate with employees before implementation. And we anticipate to bring additional reduction proposals to you in future board meetings. That concludes my financial update, and I'm happy to answer any questions you might have.
Regarding the budget, I know that a lot of fundings have been taken from the county to the state of Arizona. And we met with our legislators explaining to them what has been taken and that we needed those revenues back here. But we made that effort. So with that, I think it's not that we're not doing anything about it. We're moving forward, trying to retrieve as much funding as we can. Continuing to struggle to demand. Any questions or comments?
Chairman?
If I may, Chairman, I'll echo what the chairman had to say. It's not like we've sat on our hands and said, hey, you know, we just accept to stay cautious. We spent a significant amount of time and energy as a board, as Navajo County, in trying to educate the legislature, not only our elected officials that represent us, but others, in trying to help them understand the negative impacts. While much of the rest of the state sees sunshine and rainbows today and is coming out of that economic condition, we're just not as well presented by you today. And I think they're starting to get that message, but getting the message isn't enough. It requires action. And unfortunately, we've yet to see much in the way of reduction. My concern at this point is we have a lot of new legislators that are there, that for them, this is business as usual. They don't understand the cost shifts that have occurred since 2008. So for them, this is business as usual. And we've done a lot this year. I spent a significant amount of time, as has been on the board, down to the Capitol trying to help them in consideration of this understanding. This is not business as usual, and it's not bright and sunny days here in Navajo County and in most of rural Arizona. It's, you can't look at the state as a whole and say we're all the same, because we're just not. And furthermore, going to show the economics that are in our region and what's happening here, it's not that they're not hearing, we're just not seeing the action that's necessary to be able to do so. One thing I would say is I appreciate you taking the time, you and all staff taking the time to put this together. As we look at, it's scary to look down the rabbit hole. It's not something that a lot of people want to do. A lot of people want to close their ears, close their eyes, and pretend like it's not real and the day will never come. But unfortunately, that's not what, in my opinion, a leader does. That's not what we need to be doing as we represent Navajo counties. We need to look at what is in front of us, what we do face, and for viable solutions moving forward. So I appreciate the comments that were given earlier, because it sounds like many are concerned about those same things, and the comments that you've just given. So the perspective is necessary. Thank you. Thank you, Chairman.
Thank you. Any questions, comments?
Chairman?
Brian, thank you for your report. I've been impressed with staff. I know there's been ongoing and consistent efforts and regular meetings with various board members trying to educate us, and as we try to work together to do what we can to educate the legislators. Is it fair to say, you know, there may be, we've been talking about budget issues every day for months, but there's probably a lot of people that aren't in those conversations, and maybe they're hearing some of this for the first time, or they just have heard rumors. Is it fair to say that with NGS, the Navajo Generating Station, the announcement of that closure, that caught people by surprise, everyone a little bit by surprise at how quickly they talked about shutting that down, and that's a signal. That's part of the reason why we're seeing as many challenges as we're going to see here coming up. Is that a significant factor?
Mr. Chairman, Supervisor, absolutely. We've been talking since I've been here about the impacts of Choya and planning for that. But the announcement of NGS was a complete surprise to us, and I would say most around the state as well. And that has certainly accelerated, provided the need to have these discussions and how to plan before it happens.
With, Chairman, with NGS shutting down the end of 2019, am I correct in understanding that they're actually beginning to decommission? If they're shutting down at the end of 2019, they have to be done by 2019, which means they're in the process of decommissioning that plant well in advance. Is that right?
Mr. Chairman, Supervisor, the manager or Paul may be able to speak a little bit better to that than me.
Mr. Vice Chairman Williams, right now, Salt River Project, who's one of the four owners of Navajo Generating Station and the operator of NGS, is in conversations with the Navajo Nation regarding a two-year extension of the current agreement, which does expire in December of 2019. And actually, Councilman Jack could speak to this even more specifically than me. Right now, SRP has asked Navajo Nation for a two-year extension of that December 2019 agreement. If there's not an agreement reached by July 1st of this year, SRP is forced to start a decommissioning that requires basically that plant to go back to bare dirt by December of 19. So currently SRP is working with the Navajo Nation to have a two-year extension of the decommission. So their intention is, Mr. Chairman, SRP's intention is to operate that plant through December of 2019 and then have a two-year decommissioning process.
Any other questions? Comment, Supervisor Jack?
Well, I'll just speak to the closure of the plant, closure of the Navajo Generating Station. And I also sit on the Navajo Nation Council. And this is a really big, big concern. But the tribes are working very hard with the owners and also the interior in Washington, D.C. to see what they can come up with to keep the plant going for at least another 2 years and beyond. So there was a meeting in Washington, D.C. with all the players. Task given to the tribe and the owners, and see if they can come up with some kind of solution to keep the plant open after 2019. So there's going to be another meeting that's going to happen, and I think it's the first week of next month. So this is really impacting the whole Navajo County. Northern Arizona, and we've been meeting with the miners. It's about close to 400 miners that could face losing their job, and they're really they don't take it very well. Decommission. That's going to come before the council, at least by May. So most likely the council will consider that. And then at least they will keep the plant open for another 2 years till 2019. So there's a lot of talks still going on, what the owners and the, also BIA, and this, you know, and I know it's gonna, we stand to lose a lot if that happens. You know, not only with the Indian Nation, but also towns up here and other counties. So I think the state needs to understand that. As mentioned by my colleague here, you know, not all counties are the same. You know, rural counties are different than big cities like Phoenix, Tucson. So I think something is gonna happen. That, you know, something is good gonna happen. That's what I believe. Something's gonna be worked out, and then Trump's policy of reopening up the mines, lessen the restriction on EPAs, you know. So that, I think that's, you know, that makes the future a little bit more brighter too. So yeah, it's what we, you know, the two tribes that I, you know, they really rely on their natural resources. And that's a big part of their revenues and their budget too. So, thank you, Chair.
Thank you,
Chairman. Just a follow-up question for Mr. Layton. I know that what we're dealing with right now is we have to go forward as if MGS is closing, because that's what we've been told, unless something changes. But let's just say for a second that things changed and NGS isn't closing. What's our forecast as a county at that point?
If NGS does not close, that means,
or if it extends for 2 years,
or extends. Well, if it extends, then we would continue to receive the sales tax money that we're currently getting from the Kayenta mine. We would, and we would also continue to receive the $200,000 that the mine pays in property tax each year.
My question is, are we still financial? We still have the same struggles that you're talking, that you've been through. That's the question.
Chairman, Supervisor, that's a good point. It delays it for 2 years. We still have the $1 million from Cholla. It's already begun its close down. And we see just the normal cost increases. We have the normal pressures that, because we have not invested in staff, we have not had the opportunity to invest in staff, and have not had the opportunity to invest in vehicles, in our infrastructure, it delays the tough conversations that we need to be having.
Right away.
Chairman, thank you. One other question, follow up to that is, have we already seen, we'll keep it general, let's say from the energy sector, even since the beginning of the year, have we seen decreases from what was norm to now, showing a trend downwards, even if we prolong it for 2 years, giving us reasonable data that says, even if it was to prolong for 2 years, it wouldn't be in the same manner as it was even 6 months ago. It's trending downwards. Is that
sure.
A fair?
Chairman, Supervisor, that's a correct statement. This year, as I showed you earlier, we're trending $130,000 down in sales tax, and we can say that is attributable to the energy production sector. And we did see a decrease the year prior, too, so we are seeing, as that whole industry starts to ramp down and slow down here.
Thank you, Chairman.
Did we say in this in Paul's tip? In the future, maybe at the end of that tunnel, what are our hopes? What are ways that we can get more revenue back to the county? Right now, over the years, we have been pushed into this situation. We've been tying up our belt, and finally, this is the worst of it. So what's something that we can hope that can generate more revenue back to the county?
Mr. Chairman, it's an excellent the question. One part is the communication that we've had with our state representatives. That communication, we've been very diligent and very much appreciate all of your assistance and your help in sharing that message. We have not seen the action that the supervisor stated earlier, but that message is going out, and it's a strong message. I think we are being heard, and so I think there's some hope because we are in coordination with the rest of the counties through the County Supervisors Association, putting all our voices together in a single message to our legislature. So I think there's hope that we can have some success at the state. The other side of that internally is bringing in new businesses, and Paul Watson's update last month, earlier, he talked about some of the businesses and enterprises that he's exploring and pushing and trying to explain the benefits of being here in the region.
Believe you there's some positive things that we can hope for develop in the future, and there's much more a bigger problem out to the communities that live close to the mining and NGS. I'm not sure just other than what Representative Jack indicated, but those are some positive things we'll continue to look forward to. Again, anyone else that wish to make any further questions?
Comments?
There being none, let's go down to the next item, which is consideration of closing the juvenile detention facility effective June 30, 2017, and you have that too, Brian?
Yes, sir. So, we are proposing that we close the juvenile detention facility as it's currently operated. It's a $1.2 million annual cost to us that does not include the sheriff's contribution of providing meals and medical services to our juvenile.
I'm sorry, Brian, I'm going to skip ahead.
Okay.
We're on make direction here, child support services. I'm sorry about that.
Not a problem.
Go ahead, proceed.
We are proposing that we discontinue our child support services program. It's currently administered by our county attorney's office, and really in large part to provide an additional service here in the community. We appreciate those efforts. Ultimately, child support services is the responsibility of the state attorney general, and the state attorney general's office provides those services to all but two counties directly. Gila County and Navajo County are the only two counties which partner to provide that service. Discontinuing that program would then transfer the responsibility back to the state attorney general, and we would ask them to transition and begin to provide those services here in Navajo County. It would provide the general fund with a savings of $200,000 annually. They're asking for your dialogue and your consideration and approval to discontinue those services effective June 30th. That way it gives us time to coordinate with the state attorney general and stakeholders for a proper transition time to make sure there's a continuation of those services for our residents. Happy to answer any questions and dialogue with you at this time.
Any questions or comments?
I do have comments.
Okay.
It's my eighth budget cycle, and it's the eighth time that I've been fighting to keep our child support services operating in Navajo County. I understand the finances that this county sees, but I also understand the services that we provide to single parent families in the county and how much better we provide those services than the Attorney General's office can. It's not the Attorney General's responsibility to do child support. They have coexisting ability to do it, just like they have coexisting ability to charge criminal cases. Using that logic, get rid of my office and just tell the AG to handle all the crimes in Navajo County. But like I said, I understand the finances. The toughest part is that we've even gotten to this point where it's on the agenda. I feel like I failed my child support people. I've been fighting for 8 years to get the legislature to understand that rural Arizona and the current funding system for them is outdated and irresponsible. And it's not just us facing this crisis. You got La Paz County that's millions in debt. You have Graham County that they're subsidizing at least $500,000 a year. How far does this crisis in rural Arizona have to go before they decide they have to get off their ass and do something? And I don't want Navajo County to be the poster child for the crisis, but we're moving there. I've been on my soapbox so many times over this past 8 years. I'm on my soapbox again. You've heard every argument I've had for child support individually and as a group. I won't go through all of them again because you're probably tired of hearing them, and I'll probably do myself more harm by doing it. For some, it may be $200,000 in savings. For me, it's 8 people I consider friends. Mike Espino, the head of it, I've worked with Mike since I moved to Navajo County in 1992. Long relationship. Same with Guy. He was at the public defender's office when I came here in 1992. You know my arguments. You know the administration's finance department's position. It's in your hands. Do what you believe is right.
Reiterating what the county attorney says, we have seen over time how much effort has been put into trying to get those revenues back to where they need to be. Efforts have been made year after year. And there's some really brilliant people in here that are going to be impacted. I knew Mike for a long time. Back from Flagstaff, a lot of years. These are who are our friends. I know that they can to continue working on putting their recommendations, suggestions together. We can pass through this. We all have that faith that we can see better days in years to come. Now I turn over to supervisors. What are your, do you have any further questions or comments?
Chairman, just a comment. So Brad, I want to thank you for, I know how strongly you felt about child support. I know the good service that your office has provided. And I'm with you that local control is always better when you can control things locally. I also, you know, as we sit here, I only speak for myself. I don't pretend to speak for the other supervisors, but when issues are brought before us, there's the financial aspect to things, and then there's also the human element. It affects people. Choices that you make, decisions you make affect people. This is a, if the board approves this, it's going to impact some people, their jobs, effective July 1. The child support program itself, I know that 13 of the 15 counties, like you said, Brian, 13 of the 15 counties, this service is provided by the Attorney General's office. Maybe it's not ideal to have the Attorney General's office do it. Maybe the ideal is to have the county attorney's office do it. But in times where you've got to make tough decisions and you can still have a service provided for our citizens, only through a different office, then I think sometimes in leadership you've got to step up and square your shoulders. It's sometimes you make decisions that aren't easy, but you do the best you can and what you feel like is the best decision for the county as a whole. And
And so I say that to Brad, thank you for the service your office has provided. It's not an easy decision, but if the board were to support this, that service would still be provided to our citizens.
Supervisor White?
Chairman, I also want to echo a thank you to Brad, to his office. For the last, as you've mentioned, for 8 years, you've validated and given a good reason why you've been successful in providing a service that's been necessary and worked for our citizens. Unfortunately, as we look down this rabbit hole and we look at the cost that's in front of us, and we see that this is not a mandated service for Arizona counties, it's one that makes sense why staff brought it back to us to take a look at. These services would be provided by the state attorney general's office as required by statute, and would be a $200,000 savings. So while at least the numbers that I saw up on the board, we're looking at a several million dollar shortfall, this is this would be $200,000 towards that. Again, Supervisor Williams did a great job of talking about this also affects human people, which makes this difficult. Financially, we have to look at the whole of the county, the services that were required by the state to provide, and also take into consideration the human element of it. So we have to make some tough decisions here today. It's not without understanding that I'll make a decision here shortly. So I appreciate the words that have been shared, the efforts. I don't want to get out in front of anybody if they have additional comments they want to make, Chairman, before we vote.
Chairman.
Supervisor Worthing.
First, thank you, Brian. I appreciate tackling a very, very challenging, decision and helping us to be better informed. And I think some of the things is we have learned in our service here as supervisors is understanding the budget capacity and what does that look like in our relationship with the state and with outside organizations and how they impact us. There's a direct correlation. And so when we look at what does that correlation mean for a long-term relationship, we began to learn that those relationships can't always be trusted, or we can't always look to those state relationships to understand rural counties. We can't expect state lawmakers to support that partnership on a continued basis. Certainly our conversations are changing. And I say that because when I think of the dollars and how we advocate to receive more dollars into our county or to support certain parts of services that were expected, that is by law that we are responsible for providing, that we need the relationship and the partnership of the state to be able to help us to supplement and to be able to provide sound services to the people who live in Navajo County. And when we're faced with a tough decision like this, and not only the human perspective, certainly we understand this is impacting the people who work for Navajo County and your loyalty and your dedication and your commitment to service for many, many years, but it also impacts the people who live within the county and looking outside of our county to find ways to receive those services. As a single parent, you might not have the resources to be able to take a trip somewhere else. It might be a bit more challenging and more difficult, and you might need that personal advocation for somebody to help you. And so when we look at this, the human factor is certainly, I think, the first factor that we're looking at, and it becomes very difficult. But when we go back to understanding our relationship with outside entities who impact the dollars that we receive and the services that we provide, certainly we have a responsibility. When you look at our responsibility as supervisors, that we are responsible in protecting and overseeing and championing and supporting taxpayers and the dollars that come to us and being able to be fiscally sound. And so when we're not looking at the future and we're not planning for the future and maybe making decisions that could negatively impact our future, and not only as employees, but as an organization and the people who live within the county. I appreciate your support. I appreciate your perspective and the way that you have tackled this, because we want to be proactive. We don't want to be in the position where we are looking at tomorrow being the day where we don't have the dollar. And it impacts us on a quite, it's more catastrophic. We are certainly sitting in a crisis position that we don't want to be in. But if we look away and don't make tough decisions, that crisis position begins to grow. And so I appreciate that you're forcing and us to look at a very difficult conversation, because we as a board certainly want to be proactive. And the services that are provided through Brad and his leadership, that we appreciate his advocation for community. You know, I can always look to Brad as someone who understands that his position as the county attorney is important to representing and to speaking on behalf of the people that he serves. And with the leadership and those who work under him and the capacity that he's been able to grow, I appreciate that as a leader. And so I thank you for that, Brad.
Any other comments? What's the wish of the board?
Mr. Chairman, I believe you need a motion first.
Let's do
this. Correct me if I'm wrong.
No, there has not been no motion.
No.
Okay. Chairman,
what's the wish of the board? Supervisor?
Chairman, I think that's what you were asking for, was for a motion, right?
Mm-hmm.
Or from us.
All right.
I guess since you pointed at me, it's not an easy decision to make, Chairman, but based on the financial shortfall that we're looking at, I'd make a motion that we approve as presented by staff the moving forward with the discontinuation of child support services by the county attorney's office.
Second.
There's a motion and a second to discontinue child support services effective June 30th, 2017. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed? There being none, motion carries. And again, I think we should not turn away from this. How much more can we come together and to discuss the issue to make it what we want it to be in the future? It's, I think we've heard a lot of you people, and we do appreciate all those concerns expressed there. Going on to the next item is Brian again. Consideration of closing the juvenile detention facility effective June 30, 2017. Brian?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Our juvenile detention facility has an annual cost of $1.2 million. Again, that does not include the cost of meals and medical that is provided by the sheriff. You know, partnership currently with Apache County, they paid us $90,000 a year annually. That equates to about 7% of our total operating costs. To give us some perspective on the population, it's a 40-bed facility, and we average 7.1 juvenile offenders in the facility. The median is 7, so it tells us that it's a very consistent population. Just under 80% of those in the facility are from Navajo County, Navajo County's partners, the cities and counties. 18% of the population is from Apache County, and then 3% is BIA, DPS, and other entities that we house. So just some perspective there. We have 16 full-time positions and 7 part-time positions that currently staff that facility. In Arizona, currently, there's 4 counties that use contract agreements with other counties to provide housing for juvenile offenders. Most recently, as the sheriff talked about, was Gila County, which closed its doors in December of this past year, very abruptly, and they now send their juvenile offenders to Pinal County. Apache County, in 2015, was forced to close their doors, and now sends their juvenile offenders to our facility. And La Paz and Greenlee have had long-standing agreements. Greenlee partners with Grant County, and La Paz partners with Yuma County. So overall, a total of 8 counties work together and cooperatively to provide juvenile detention services in the state. As we debated and performed the analysis to look at an option of closing the facility and creating a partnership, we looked at several different options. First, we looked at ways to increase our own population. I personally had a talk with U.S. Marshals to explore options to bring juvenile offenders to our facility in order to achieve some economies of scale. Their volume just was not large enough, and they deal mainly with sexually violent and extremely violent juveniles, and it was just not appropriate to house in our facility. We've had talks with the counties all surrounding us. Coconino, Judge Rickle visited Coconino along with the county manager to have a discussion with their officials. That did not make sense for them, forming a partnership. And so we've continued to look and talk, and the county manager has started to open those doors with the other counties. The two most realistic, incredible options we have are with Grant County and Pinal County. As a member before, Gila County sends their juvenile offenders to Pinal County for a daily rate. As we look at Grant County, I think that holds more potential for us as a county, and especially as you heard the concerns of Judge Rickle and our staff. If you imagine using a partnership, continuing a partnership with Apache County, Greenlee, Graham, Apache County, and ourselves, you can truly look at a regional partnership. The initial discussion with Graham would not be at a daily rate, it would be at an annual rate. That way, as a group, we can plan for the entire year. Arno and his staff talked about the programming and the value of the programming and settled attention. So the reality is we can't do enough. We simply don't have the resources to provide the intensive counseling and therapy that many of these juvenile offenders need and could really benefit from. As we look at a more regional approach, using economies of scale, leveraging these partnerships with other counties, we have the opportunity to really do that, to provide those services. Again, I've heard over and over from staff, it's therapy and counseling, that these kids could really benefit from and help them in their transition back to the home life. We have that potential in a more regional partnership and make a difference in the long run. The judge brought up many concerns, and I appreciate her advocacy of the program. And that's the reason why we're coming towards you today, to make a decision now. It gives us time to begin a thorough conversation and a thorough partnership, development of partnership. Looking at transportation, we have the opportunity to continue to partner with Apache County. The sheriff expressed his support to provide transportation, so there's synergies that we can work out. Again, we have 8 counties in the state that have just gone through this transition or have been doing it for years. We can learn from that. So moving forward, we engage in quality discussions with those folks, both from Grant and Pinal. We've had invitations to visit their facilities and tour their facilities. to talk with their directors and administrators. We would absolutely involve judges and staff in that, so we can make sure that we're addressing all the concerns, that we're learning from the lessons that they've already passed through. Again, this is a very difficult decision. The other point that was raised is the distance, correct, between a juvenile offender, parents, legal counsel. We have the opportunity to explore technology and learn from what the other counties is doing to invest in technology to allow for a real face-to-face connection, leveraging technology that's available to us now to facilitate those interactions with legal counsel. And we would need to do something here locally so those families that do not have immediate access or reliable access to the internet, we can provide a mechanism here locally that they can come locally and then engage their kids or the same attorneys with our clients. That is our presentation, our proposal regarding juvenile detention. I'm happy to engage in dialogue and questions you might have.
The concern that has been expressed reminds me at one time in the past, all the leadership took a trip down to the juvenile center. And we went through that. As we went through that place with a young child way back there, he singled me out. And he said, I'm going to talk to you. And he said some beautiful things. And these are the kids that we're talking about. So I can understand why that concerns are being expressed. Now we have to do certain things because of the financial issue that we're in. I just want to bring that up. Any comments, questions? Supervisors?
I have a question. One of the statements that continually came up and the statements that were made previously was about, is it truly cost effective? So when we look at $600,000, is that an annual saving or is that a projection for the first year or what does that look like?
Chairman, Supervisor, that's an annual savings. It's $1.2 million to operate the facility currently. If you back out the $90,000 that Apache currently pays us, through the discussions that we've had so far with management in those two counties, whether we go with a daily rate or an annual rate, plus some additional costs for transportation that we will incur, yes, that is an annual projected savings.
Any other comments?
Thank you, Chairman. I have a couple of questions. Just to clarify, there was a few statements made that maybe want to ask some questions. Brad, before you go, I have one for you, if that's okay. I'm sorry.
Okay.
One of the questions that was made very early on was, is this legal? I suspect staff has run this by you to talk to you about it. As far as, is it legal to provide this service just in a different manner? Because I don't see how the service is not being provided, but I want to get your take as far as the reality.
Mr. Chairman, Supervisor Whiting, when you read Title 8, dealing with detention centers, it says the residing juvenile judge shall be over the detention center. And it also gives the county the right to partner with public or private entities to run a detention center. It does not explicitly state in Title 8 that detention center has to be in the county, in this case Navajo County.
I would be hard pressed to see what other public entity within the county could handle a running the doing the detention center. It would imply that by being able to contract with public entities, that would include other counties. So it's one of those gray areas. It's not explicit it has to be in, and it's not explicit that we can contract out. Saying that there's three other counties that have already contracted out, and Greenlee having done it for years and years and years, that would further indicate that it would be permissible to do so.
Thank you, I appreciate it. Sorry, Bill DeVille. If okay, Chairman, I have a couple more questions.
Sure.
Chairman, I have a question for Sheriff Clark. Earlier it was mentioned that it could be putting the county at risk when we have detention officers that are driving these juveniles out of on long distances to take them to potentially Graham or Pinal County. My question to you would be, do you see it as it would put the county at critical or unacceptable risk when delivering these? It wouldn't seem so to me, but that's not my area of expertise, so I wanted to get your take on that, if that's okay.
No. The sheriff's office travels across the state now. Been here 30 years. I know two times that the sheriff's office transport, one time in the Salt River Canyon, a rock fell and hit the transport van. And a few years ago, we had a DO that fell asleep and rolled the van. Nobody was on the van. DOC travels probably 50 times the distance that we do, and you don't see problems there. Anytime you travel a road supervisor, sure, there could be. I mean, you have impaired vehicle people out there, you have careless driver speed, but every precaution is taken. So I think that's a weak argument.
Yeah. Okay, I appreciate your perspective. A couple more questions. There was a number that was given out earlier on the numbers that you're providing here today. If I see that correctly, we're looking at a facility that costs $1.2 million, and the number that staff is providing is that $1.2 million is spent on an average of 7.1 juveniles that are in there. There was a number earlier that was provided by somebody that got up and spoke, and they said the average number was 15. I don't expect you to be able to speak to theirs, but your number, the 7.1, how did you come up with that number?
So we receive a daily count from the juvenile, and that's compiled. And so we've been compiling that over time in order to get a good feel and a good estimation of what the population is over time. So those are just daily counts that are added up.
So that's the average of 7.1.
Correct.
So 1.2 million on 7.1 juvenile offenders. Is that correct?
Yeah. On average a day. Correct.
Perfect. Okay. I want to make sure I have that clear in my head. And then Supervisor White Senior did a good job. On that 600,000, there was also put in question saying that was unlikely and that we would probably see none. Do you mind just re-verifying why you feel confident in that savings?
Absolutely. So I feel confident, Chairman Supervisor, because we've already engaged these other entities, and Grant especially, we've engaged in such suits, so we have a real good view of what those dollar amounts would be. Looking at transportation costs, the cooperation with the sheriff, it will be more that we've added in capacity to that. So the new cost plus transportation cost plus backing out the $90,000 that we received from Apache County, I feel confident that we will receive that $600,000 savings.
So I don't want to put words in your mouth, but at least what it sounds like I'm hearing is that's a conservative estimate.
I think that's a very solid estimate.
I think that's the end of my questions, Chairman.
Supervisor Williams?
Chairman, thank you. So, Brian, just a couple of things. When one of the concerns that was raised in call to the public was that stakeholders hadn't been talked to about it, would you just address who staff has talked to and communicated with? Leading up to today's proposal.
Supervisor, Mr. Chairman.
The
reductions are, everything that you've talked about today, that human element of discussing reductions, it is hard. It's hard on staff when you talk openly. And so we've not had those discussions at the staff level. We have engaged at the judge level to have that discussion. So as I mentioned before, as we began in discussions with other counties, Judge Ripple actually accompanied the county manager to Coconino on one occasion. And we've been meeting with the presiding judges and trying to keep them updated on these. Again, we've done what we could to open the door. And the real need here moving forward is we need the input from staff, from judges, as we iron out the details and really develop the agreement that will work for everyone. To this point, it's been mainly with the judges.
Mr. Supervisor Williams, I know, understand, Brian, you have met with Arno and that team. Can you speak to that, please?
Certainly, yes. Excuse me. That was very recently. I'll say it's in the past 2 weeks that I've had that discussion with them about specifics of what could be accomplished with partnerships, who you've spoken to. That's all been the last 2 weeks.
So here's, Chairman, here's my understanding, because this is, conversations on this have been going on for a few months. My understanding is when the conversations began, the initial conversation was reaching out to neighboring counties to see if they would partner us to bring their juveniles here. Is that correct?
Yes.
For example, Apache County, there was contact with Apache County asking them if they would be a bigger partner so that we could keep a facility here. Is that right?
That's correct.
When Gila County shut theirs down, we reached out to Gila County and asked them if they would be interested in partnering with us to bring their juveniles here, as well as Graham County. Is that accurate?
Yes, sir.
And the response that I wasn't part of those conversations, so I'm hearing that from staff, but my understanding is all of those counties, Apache said, were not able or interested or whatever their reason, were not going to partner more substantially than we have in the past. And Gila and Graham said, we're not interested in bringing juveniles up to you. Is that accurate?
Yeah, Mr. Chairman, Supervisor Williams, forgive me for not fully understanding the earlier question. These Arizona counties have been in conversations for a substantial amount of time. And I had specifically talked with the previous Gila County manager, and I had even talked to Judge Rickle at the time about our conversations with Gila, because obviously the first priority was, how can we enhance the capacity in our existing juvenile detention facility in Navajo County? So I had talked to the previous Gila County manager at length on multiple occasions about the potential us partnering, whether it was in Globe or it was in Holbrook. I advocated for Holbrook because we have a larger, nicer facility than they have there. He left in December, and then their facility closed overnight in December. That's what happened. And they sent their kids to Florence, and that's what they're doing right now. So that door closed. But for some time now, I have been visiting with my counterpart in Grant County about what a regional effort could look like. And again, I've advocated for Holbrook. But again, right now, Greenlee has a long-standing relationship with Graham that they weren't willing to walk away from. I know Apache has talked to Graham, and my understanding, based on our conversations with Pinal, that they've talked to Pinal as well on exploring where they would like to go as well. About 2 months ago, Brian and I met with Apache County about options. They made it clear to us that they weren't interested in paying any more money to us, and that we would likely both be exploring another option. And that very well, as Mr. Chairman, as Brian has outlined, could be Graham County. And again, I've been in communication with my counterpart there, along with Pinal County, to explore. But we do have two responsible options, should the board move forward today, moving forward as an organization.
So I guess thank you for that, and Chairman, I guess I was just a little bit surprised when one of the allegations was that stakeholders hadn't been part of the conversation, because I'll just tell you from my perspective, in speaking with staff and in some of the meetings I've been in, I know that staff and
has met with at least three of the four Superior Court judges in multiple meetings about it, and I've been personally involved in some of those. I know that staff has talked to other county managers about the issue. I know that staff has met with all of the town managers and talked with it. I know staff has met with the sheriff's office and talked about it. I know the county attorney's office has had discussions about it. And 2 weeks ago, we had a presentation from juvenile probation. So I guess I was just confused that a proposal was being made to the board where people hadn't been invited to the table, because that's not been my perspective. My perspective, it has been, many people have been part of the discussion on that. If I can just share a couple of thoughts here, this is not questions, these are just thoughts. So this is a difficult one, probably, I'm guessing, for all of the board. This is a difficult one on a lot of levels. I think from a cost savings perspective, I think it's pretty clear that there's a significant cost savings to the county. I think it's hard to argue anything other than that from what's been presented. In another life, I've been an attorney, and I've represented juveniles. And I don't have any statistics to back this up, but I will tell you my experience in representing juveniles in the criminal justice system is they don't have family support, which is why they're in the system most of the time. Sometimes you get juveniles that do come from strong families, but most of the time they come from broken homes. And it was always difficult when I would have a juvenile in detention because they would never have family come and visit them. I shouldn't say never. That's the exception, because they don't have family support. And families ought to have access to be able to visit their kids if they will. But on a population that probably needs help more than any group, how can we help them if their families aren't there to support them? And it seems to me we need to provide increased services and treatment and counseling. And part of the problem, I think, in my time as an attorney and on the board, due to limited funds, I don't know that we've been able to provide the necessary counseling and treatment and services that these juveniles need to go down a different path and change their life. And for me, one of the key elements in the discussion has been, if there's a partnership, if we're going to partner with other counties, is it going to provide an opportunity to provide greater services to these kids? And one of the things that staff has communicated to me, and I heard you say it again today, Brian, is you see this as an opportunity in discussions with Pinal and Graham County to provide a better level, a higher level of counseling and treatment and services if we go that route than what we've been able to do, not because of lack of ability with staff, but because of a lack of resources that we've had. Is that fair to say?
Supervisor, yes, it's very fair to say.
So in an ideal world, we wouldn't be having this conversation about closing down a juvenile detention center or relocating our juveniles to another county. And I've tried to look at this through the lens of a judge or an attorney and an employee. And if one of my kids ended up in a juvenile detention facility, I mean, these are, you end up being conflicted as you look at the different viewpoints. I've tried to look at it from a macro perspective, from a board, tried to look at it financially, and it's a difficult decision. But the truth is, at some point you've got to make decisions, and I think in leadership you gather all of the relevant information that you can, and you make the best decision that you know how to make for the county and for the kids and for all of the people that are impacted. It's not an easy decision, but I think that the movement is towards regionalizing these detention facilities. I think you're going to see it. I think you're going to see a movement to shut down the ADJC at the state level, and I think you're going to see a movement to regionalize these, which we've already seen. There's eight counties already doing it. It's not an easy decision. I respect Judge Rickle very much and her views. I don't disagree with anything that she said. And I've been in her court, and I know how she
cares about those juveniles. I watch probation. I know how they care about it. And I think everyone wants what's best for the juveniles. They want what's best for the kids, and they also want what's best for the county as a whole. And so we can look at it through, we look at it through different lenses, and we may come to different conclusions, but I think everyone's intent is to do what's best for the kids and the county as a whole. It's tough, it's a tough decision, but when you weigh things out, I feel like I know where I need to land on the issue. So I want to thank everyone that came and presented their views. Sometimes it takes courage to stand up and give your views, whether they're popular or not popular, so I appreciate that.
Supervisor Whiting.
Thank you, Chairman. Just something to clarify, and I wanted to ask Mr. Jane, if that's all right. As far as the proposal, you're proposing today, if I understand correctly, the options of Graham or Pinal, but you've talked with both viable options, and that's how you come up with that number. One or the other, the $600,000 in savings is a real potential, but it's option A or option B, and we have a plan in front of us. Is that correct? That it's Graham or Pinal?
Yeah, Mr. Chairman, Supervisor Whiting, we have two counties that are both, again, as Mr. Chairman, as the assistant manager mentioned earlier, are viable options for us, and we understand what the pricing structure will be. I am confident in having reviewed these numbers with Paige and Brian that the $600,000 is a conservative estimate, or Brian used the term of
solid
estimate. I understand there's some variable to that. But Mr. Chairman, this is not unprecedented. As Mr. Layton outlined earlier, there are four counties that do this, two of which have been doing it for a long time. So there's nothing, this is not plowing new ground. We will move forward, depending on what the board does today, and actively work with one of those two counties and our team here. And I have a lot of respect for Judge Rickle and Linda Wilson and Arnold Hall and that team. We will figure this out moving forward to finalize all of the details. But again, as Mr. Layton mentioned earlier as well, we have four counties also that have been doing this now, some for a short time, some longer, to also understand, Mr. Chairman, and hearing from some of the concerns that were expressed by some of the communities as far as transport and things. Patrick County and I have already talked about transport. We will get there. And having the time to do that now, Mr. Chairman, depending on what the board does today, you have our commitment for that, and in working with our internal team as well.
Chairman.
Another
question, I guess, on the process of vetting, when we're looking at partnership with, I guess, our local counties and soliciting, I guess, other inmates to come, potential juveniles to stay in our facility or to be in our facility. Did we look at other tribal communities? So if we're looking at the White Mountain Apache Tribe, Hopi, or Navajo Nation, who certainly have juveniles and utilize the McKinley County in Gallup. Was that another resource, I guess? And I don't mean to put you on the spot, but certainly want to see if we're investigating all avenues.
Certainly. I'll defer to the county manager on that question.
Yeah, Mr. Chairman, I can say that over the years, I've been here 13 and a half years, I know Arno and others have explored options for other federal contracts. We get an occasional youth from the BIA. I know that Arno and others have explored other options. At the time I've been here, none of those have come to fruition.
Thank you, Jimmy, I appreciate that. I'd also like to just make a comment. Certainly, discussing this position and trying to understand what we're accountable to. And these young people, when we talk about seven children, in fact, children a day, what does that equate to? What types of services are those students getting? What would they not be getting if they're not in our facility, if they're not localized? And so when we, I guess, weigh the pros and cons, as a person who works works with children, who's an educator, and my job is advocation of young people, and wanting to be able to provide the best services and the best support system. This becomes a contradictory conversation in a sense. And so when I'm looking to the future, not only of the young people that we serve, again, going back to my previous comments, it's about the entire community that we serve. And making decisions on behalf of the entire organization so we are able to provide sound services not only today, but far into the future is very important. And I think that we've vetted this. I think that our team has gone out and collected the information. I think that we understand the position and certainly are not moving on new territory as other counties have gone down this road as well. And today, I feel like that we don't want to be in this position, but we are in the position of sending out a very sound and clear message to our state legislators that we are in a position of financial crisis, and that my position today is to approve the closure of the Juvenile Detention Center. And I make a motion for approval, not because I don't support the human aspect, but because I have a responsibility to look to the future of the services that we provide as a county.
There is a motion to move forward. Any second?
Second.
There's a motion and a second to close the juvenile detention facility effective June 30th, 2017. All those in favor say aye.
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 Those opposed? There be no motion carried.
I oppose.
Well, one opposed. Okay, four in favor and one opposed. I think knowing that you know the vote here, what we need to do is to continue talking to our staff, continue the communication with the two programs that are impacted. And also, to what do we do to partner up with the community, with the other counties? That we have to continue to do that. And also, Brad and other organizations have been encouraging family support and to have that communication between the family and the kids, continue that. And I know that many of you are going to have a lot of ideas. And I don't think this, the communication is close to anybody, to administration. We need to continue working at it. So again, I like to turn down to the next item.